We've been going through Hebrews for this Lent series, and Hebrews is the perfect book to do Lent with, because Lent is a season about focusing on the Lord, and Hebrews is a book about how the Lord is better than lots of different things, and it brings our attention to it. And John kind of set us up by connecting how the Lord kind of ministers to us spiritually in the midst of our maladies, and so he talked about ADHD and how staying focused on the Lord is important, and then talked last week about spiritual nearsightedness and how we get caught up in everything that's in front of us and we have a hard time keeping our eyes on the big picture. And today we're going to look at one of my maladies through the words of Hebrews as well, and that's that I'm directionally challenged. I am somebody who can repeatedly go to the same place again and again and again and will still need GPS to find my way there. Christina is the exact opposite. She can go somewhere once, go back there like 2 years later and remember exactly which turns to take in order to get there. Jerry can attest to this because I would pick him up for our elder meeting and I would need to ask him where his house was almost every time I picked him up. And then I would need to use GPS to find the church again after picking him up. So thank God for GPS, because I would not even be here today, I'm sure. But I kind of feel like there's a spiritual sense of that as well, that we're all a little spiritually disoriented. We don't always know where God wants us to go at any given moment. We pray that God would direct us. We would like it if we had like a neon sign pop down and say, do this or do that. But that's not usually how things work. And especially in our life has a way of kind of introducing bigger and more difficult things into our life as we go. And sometimes we're looking around going, man, I don't know how to navigate this. The picture that always comes to my mind is that of like Indiana Jones going through a tomb to get to like the thing that he's looking for, and suddenly all the torches get blown out. And there's this moment where you go, now how do we move forward? And that's how it can be if we don't sense where God is leading us sometimes. So how do we spiritually make our way forward in unfamiliar territory, especially if you're anything like me and you find yourself directionally challenged at times? So we're going to look at Hebrews 4, 12 through 16. I did not tell Dave Doherty that was going to be the passage we were preaching on, and yet that is where he was drawn. And these themes keep popping up in the community, and that's, I think, something from the Lord. So let me read this scripture for us. It says, "The word of God is living and active. It's sharper than any sword that has two edges. It cuts deep enough to separate soul from spirit. It can separate joints from bones. It judges the thoughts and purposes of the heart. Nothing God created is hidden from him. His eyes see everything, and he will hold us accountable for everything that we do. We have a great high priest. He's gone up into the heavens. He is Jesus, the Son of God. So let's hold firmly to what we say we believe. We have a high priest who can feel it when we're weak and hurting. We have a high priest who's been tempted in every way, just as we are, but he didn't sin. So let's boldly approach the throne of grace, and we'll receive mercy. And we'll find grace to help us when we need it." I want to start with the question of where are you headed? Where do you want to be in your life? This passage follows in the Hebrews kind of stuff about talking about Joshua and how he led the people, but they couldn't enter into their rest. They couldn't enter into the promised land or their rest or their peace. And the life that God wanted for them. And that's what God promises us, life and rest and peace. And he doesn't do so by giving us a roadmap of some dead rules or regulations. He wants to lead us in this journey of life. But we're all a little spiritually, directionally challenged. And I think sometimes in Christendom, in churches and in communities, I look around at other Christians and I go, man, it seems like they hear from God really clearly. Like they got it nailed. Like, I'm sure when they pray about something, God just says, oh, you're supposed to go do this, because that's the stories that they often share with me. But I don't often hear on a Sunday morning somebody telling stories about how they hit something and they had no clue what God might want them to do in the midst of that. And they're trying to fumble their way along. And yet that's, I think, how many of us experience life. At least that's how I experience it. Maybe I'm just directionally challenged spiritually. But, I have this, as I mentioned, this knack for getting lost. I don't know if it's an actual, like, physical malady. Like, I don't know if it's that kind of a disease. But I do know that I inherited it. Because my dad was the master of getting us lost. And he didn't have GPS. It was actually pre, like, cell phone driving. And so you had your map that you would pull out. You know, you're sitting there in the car and you're trying to get somewhere. And then eventually you realize that you're not anywhere close. And so you would pull out this giant map. And then you would try to find your little street that you were on and look for the intersection. And I remember one day, I had this day that we were really looking forward to. It was going to be like the father and son bonding. According to the postcard, we were going to go to a Dodgers game. We were in Ventura. It was 2 hours away. And I was so excited because, like, dad, son, baseball game. And we got so lost, we never even made it to the game. Like, we were just driving around you don't need to know California geography, but I will tell you that Dodger Stadium is not in the nicest neighborhoods. Like, there's some rough neighborhoods that you drive through and are around. And actually, Dodger Stadium itself was in a pretty scary neighborhood, like parts of LA that I don't normally like to travel in. And so as we got lost, it was getting harder and harder to figure out where we were going, and it was getting scarier and scarier for us. So I'm going to attempt to describe my own sense of trying to navigate my dad, why it is that we can never find our way there. And this scripture that we're looking at is going to give us kind of three things, I think, that we can do that are pretty tangible, that we can grab a hold of in the midst of trying to find our way in our adventures. So, and the first thing that my dad and I don't do, that the scripture encourages us to do, is to listen. You know, you're driving along and you sense that you're not going in the right direction. And my stepmom would often go, I think we're lost. And the first response to that always was, no, we're not. I've got this. I know where we are, whether we knew where we are or not. Like, that's just the natural guy reaction to this. And Hebrews makes a point. It says, the word of God is living and active. It's sharper than a double-edged sword. It can separate the soul and spirit. It can judge the thoughts and purposes of our hearts. And nothing that God created is hidden from him. His eyes see everything. And so it's saying that God can actually see what's going on. And he's there for us to listen to him. And so he points us to his word. I think this is an encouragement to prayerfully listen to the word. There's a lot of ways you can read scripture. You can. I've done years and years of reading it for history, which is pretty cool. You can just read it for volume. Like, you can have a calendar that you check boxes off on, and you go, I'm going to read 3 chapters a day, and give yourself a pat on the back when you get the chapters done. And if you do that for a whole year, you'll actually finish the whole Bible. You can read it for other people. Anybody ever do that? Read and go, man, that sounds just like that somebody that I know. I bet if they read this scripture, they'd be a better person. We can do that. But this isn't inviting to actually listen to God's word. And when we listen, part of that is an openness to be challenged by God. It's an openness to say, God, where do I have this a little bit off? It's sort of like standing up in a mirror. A few of you have seen me on days when I showed up at church and I haven't looked in the mirror and things are a little out of whack. I remember this one particular day when we were doing a well in our house. And I came downstairs and I'm ready to greet everybody. I just got ready at the last second. And I came downstairs and somebody had shown up for church, and this lovely, sweet lady starts wiping my ear, and she goes, you got some shaving cream on there. God bless her. Wish I had looked in a mirror before I came downstairs. Scripture can be like that. And I want to give you a really, I like to get to practical at some point, so I want to give you a really practical way that I found that we can read scripture for ourselves. And it was taught to me with this acronym of SOAP, and it was like, read a chapter of scripture and ask for the Holy Spirit to point out just one verse for you. Observe one verse, find one thing in there that gets your attention, and just see it. So that's scripture, and then an observation, and then the A would be application, and that's thinking. What is God trying to tell me in this? How might this change the way I'm thinking, or the way I believe, or what I'm doing right now in my life? Is there something that God is trying to tweak in the ways that I look at life, or the way that I live out my life? And then just pray. Say, God, thanks for bringing this to my attention. I have a sense of maybe where you're leading me with this, and so I'm gonna try to be a more patient person, or I pray for your help in trusting that you are enough. I read so many scriptures that are so encouraging about God being there with us in the midst of stuff. But it's really hard to do that in the thick of stuff, isn't it? So just pray for God's help. That's what it's there for. It's there to guide us. And then another note about this. When it says the Word of God is living and active, I don't believe that only means the printed text of your Bible. It's God's Word. God speaks. And that can happen in all sorts of places. The Bible is actually, it's called the canon of Scripture. And what that means is that it's the measuring rule, so that when God speaks, it's going to agree with what's in there. But you might find God speaking through sitting there and having coffee with somebody. You might find God speaking in your small group and you go, man, I needed to hear that. Or you might find God speaking while you're out on a walk and you go, all right, that's where I need to start listening to God. I remember in Bible school, I went into Bible school. I'd been a Christian about 5 months when I went into Bible school. And so I honestly, the only time I'd read the Bible before I was a Christian, I'd asked my dad, like, hey, I think it'd be cool to read the Bible. I want to kind of know what it has to say. Where should I start? And he goes, well, I don't know. I guess you start at the beginning and you just work your way through it. And that worked pretty well for the Genesis creation story. And then I got to, like, lineages of people. And so-and-so begat so-and-so begat so-and-so begat so-and-so, and they were all names I couldn't pronounce. I'm like, wow, that doesn't say much. And I was done. So then I came to faith, and I felt a leading to go into ministry, and I thought, well, it might be a good time to revisit that whole idea of knowing what the Bible might have to say if I'm going to go preach it or something. So I went off to Bible school, and I felt like I caught up on like 15 years of Sunday school in like a year. And that was my full-time job, was learning the scriptures. And I was sitting there with one of my professors at lunch one day, and he said, how's school going for you? How's this process been for you? And I said, you know, I feel like I'm finally starting to get a handle on what the Bible says and on scripture. I feel like I kind of am getting a grip on some of this stuff. And he said, well, that's not really what we're trying for, actually. He said, has the Bible got its grip on you yet? Is scripture reading you? Does God have a handle on you? That's the question. And it was a profound moment of realizing we don't come to the Word to try to just learn something. We come to the Word because God needs to have a handle on our lives for us to navigate it well. And so we put ourselves before the Word and we let it speak. So that first thing was just listen. There's a great Amy Grant song. It's actually taken from a Psalm 119, 105. Thy word is a lamp to my feet. You ever feel like you're in a dark spot and you're trying to navigate your way and you're tripping over things? God's word can be that. It can lighten the direction. It can give you the next step. And when you're walking with a lamp, it rarely lights up 50 miles ahead, which is what we ask for. God, give me the whole plan. I want to know what I'm going to be doing for the next 5 years, because this would be so much easier if you did this. But God says, I'll give you light for the day. just come, listen. I have this little bracelet. I got it. It's called a Misfit, which I think fits me better than a Fitbit or something. But it's designed to check my steps, and it like can check my heart rate and stuff. And so when I sleep, it can tell me if I got a good night's sleep, which it usually says that I didn't. But this thing somehow miraculously can track these. Now Christina has one too, and. And hers, she just touches it and it does a little readout. Mine can't do that. And so I have to like look at my phone, and she's like, hey, that's cool that you have that. When was the last time you actually looked at any of your stats to figure out if you're actually exercising or sleeping? I'm like 4 days ago, maybe? 5 days ago? And she goes, well, it's not doing you any good then, is it? She's right. She often is. Where she uses hers, she's like on a walk with our dog, and she taps it, and she's like, oh, I need another 2,000 steps. We got to go further. And I'm like, oh, it's raining. Just take me home. That's how I think Scripture can be. It can read our hearts. It can check our hearts in ways that nothing else can. It can discern where we are and where we need to be going and bring to light things that we need to hear in ways that we can actually hear it. God has given us a great heart monitor in the Scriptures. And will we listen to him? So that's the first thing, listening. The second one is, it says, let me read that scripture again for us. It says, to hold fast to Christ. We've kind of been talking about this the last few weeks too. It says, we have a great high priest. He has gone up into the heavens. He's Jesus, the Son of God. So let us hold firmly to what we say we believe, is that Jesus is Lord and that Jesus saves. We have this great high priest who has gone up into heaven, and he's the one unique Son of God, unlike anyone else. If you were going to go up one of the mountains in Nepal, like the Himalayas, if you were going to do that, you're going to need a Sherpa, right? And I would suggest not just finding like the first person that you see and being like, you look like a Sherpa, could you guide me up the mountain? Or in Rainier, we always hear every year some story about somebody who's trying to climb Rainier and they just got lost. We need a good Sherpa, we need a good guide, and this tells us that Jesus is the great high priest. One, and he's in heaven. He knows how to get us there. He's there himself. I think about in John 14 how he says, one day you're going to be where I am going. And they go, Jesus, we don't know the way to where you're going. And he says, what do you mean you don't know the way? You just hung out with me for 3 years. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. If you walk with me, you will be on the way. Stick with a good guide. This was something that my dad and I also didn't do very well in terms of directions. Rarely did we actually get directions from somebody. We sort of like would get ourselves lost, and this is especially pre-GPS time, and then it was like, find somebody walking down the street, right? Roll down your window, pull up next to them and be like, do you have any clue how to get to Dodger Stadium? And we had no clue of their qualifications for whether they would know the way. We kind of hoped that they were from the area, and so they'd be like, oh yeah, it's just a little further up, and then you take a left, and then you go past the grocery store, and after you hit the grocery store, go right, and you should be there. Because they were in the middle of their day. And I used to work at this gas station when I was in Bible school, and the ironic thing about it was, it was one of the only places you could walk to because I didn't have a car. I didn't even own my first car yet. So I'm in this gas station working. One of the things that people would do is they'd pull up to a gas station, walk in, and ask for directions. Okay, I travel all of about a quarter mile to my Bible school, to the gas station, and back. I have no clue of the area. I don't even own a car. And here I am, the person to give you directions. So I would pull out my map and then show them how directionally challenged I was, and together we would come up with a horrible plan for getting them to where they were going. this scripture tells us that we have the best person to give us directions ever. We have the best pastor ever in Christ. We have this great high priest who knows how to get us there. He is uniquely qualified to do that. He knows God's kingdom. He knows the way to life. And part of the trick of being directionally challenged is that we often think we know the way. And early on in my walk, there came a decision point. This whole thing of Jesus Christ as Lord in my life. And I had to decide, do I trust me to find my way to the best life that God has for me? Or do I trust the Lord? And I think we revisit that same decision again and again. Especially in times of stress. We look around and we go, man, I want to go this way. I think I can handle it this way. And or we can stop and go, God, help. I need your direction, and I'm going to trust you. Or we meet moments in our lives where we go, I'm going to do what God wants or what I want, and they're not the same thing. What do I do? And the writer of Hebrews says, pick a good guide. Trust me. Even over yourself, trust me. I know what I'm doing. The stuff I'm going to lead you to, joy, peace, patience, self-control, kindness, these are good things. This life in heaven that I want you to have, that is a good thing. Stick with me, you'll end up in a good place. Christina and I got the joy of going on a trip to Italy, and we couldn't decide whether to go on like a guided trip with someone and like have a guide show us all the sights. We knew we didn't just want to like go and wander around, because that would end up with us being in a really spectacular place and being like, wow, this stuff's old. That's pretty. And so we eventually decided on Rick Steves, because we liked him, and he was cool, and he had audio tapes that we could listen to before we went to things. And but as we were going around, there were all these people walking around Italy, and they had like these giant umbrellas. Sunny day, it's nice out, and they're walking around with these umbrellas, and they have them way up in the air. And there were guides for groups. And every time you showed up at like some monument or whatever, there would be somebody gathering people in and going, hey, for X number of dollars, I can show you this thing too. But I had no clue who they were. And honestly, if I was like 25 and an Italian and didn't have a job, I'd be like, I don't think I'll just go hang out at the Coliseum and hold an umbrella up and see how much money I can make. And then I'd just point at stuff and be like, see that thing? That thing's awesome, because, well, I wouldn't know what I was talking about. If you want to make your way through life, find someone who knows life, the creator of life, Jesus. One last thing, and this is probably the most important thing. Verses 15 and 16. We have a high priest who can feel it when we're weak and hurting. We have a high priest who's been tempted in every way, just as we are, but he didn't sin. So let us boldly approach the throne of grace, and we will receive mercy. We'll find grace to help us when we need it. We don't have a God who is far away and who doesn't recognize what it is to be in our shoes. I think a lot of times we look at God and we think that, well, he's up there and we're accountable to him. And so he's probably looking down and he's perfect and he sees how incredibly imperfect we are. And so he's sitting there waiting to go, man, what a disappointment. I can't tell you how many Christians that I've talked to. And in my own life, I've felt like this sometimes, where I'm like, man, I just blew it again. God's given me so many chances, and yet, he must be really disappointed. That's probably the overall sense. God's disappointed. And we have this idea of God being really far off, and what the scripture tells us is that Jesus came and was one of us. He walked around in our shoes. He was tempted in every way. And if you read through the scriptures, he is tempted with pride, with status, with recognition, with facing pain in a future he didn't like and needing to go that direction, with rejection, with betrayal. Christ gets it. If you've ever sat and talked to somebody who's gone through the same stuff as you, there's like this special connection where they go, man, they get it. Like, people who've had counselor, when they talk to each other, they get it in a way that I can't get it when I sit there and talk to them. Oh, man, that must be hard. And they go, yeah. But if they're sitting there talking to somebody else who's had cancer, they go, yeah, we face this thing together. Christ faces life with us. He knows what it's like. He knows how hard it is. The other thing is that we have a loving Father, and how do you think about a parent, a loving parent, seeing their kid in struggle? The parent's probably not, man, what a disappointment again. I haven't heard a lot of parents talk about their kids as the greatest disappointment of their life. They hurt for them. They go, I wish there was something I could do. I would do anything to see them. And I wish just for a moment that I could communicate with them in a way that could help them take some good steps forward. I know they're the steps that they have to take, but I want to be there for them, to support them, and help them do this. When we bring our life to God, that is who He is. God is sitting there, a loving parent, going, I want you to have the best life possible. You can bring anything to me, and I'm here to help you, and I would love to do that. Great high priest who sympathizes with us. And then it says, so be bold. Bring it all. Whatever's going on in your life. I loved how Will said, let's bring God all the great stuff that's going on, as well as all the junk that's going on, knowing that God is there for us. We don't have to do image control or pretenses with God. I know that at first, my brief church experiences before I went into Bible school, I had gone to an Episcopalian church, and it was a very, very high church, and you had to be very proper and say the right things at the right time. So that's kind of how I thought it should be with God. And so I was very reverent. I was very careful about what I would say. And I wanted to honor God with every word that I ever said out of my mouth. And that wasn't a horrible thing, but the problem was it began to create this distance. So when I would pray with God, I would say, oh, Holy Father, I know that you are awesome and I am not. Let thy will be done. And I would try to, like, think of beautiful things to say to God. And then I was dating this girl, and I thought, man, this might be the one in Bible school. And then we broke up, and I went out into the woods, and I was walking, and I sat down, and I was going to pray. And I looked over, and there was a family of deer, like, 10 feet from me. And that wasn't the miracle, because deer could be anywhere. The miracle was in that moment I knew God was with me. And something in me broke. And it was the same thing that broke for the prophet Jeremiah in Lamentations, when he just like lays into God and goes, God, why is this happening? And just blah. Verbal vomit of all the difficulties I had faced in my life, and especially that one in that moment. And I just broke before God, and I yelled at him. The first time in my walk. And it was the most freeing, amazing thing. And that same professor who had asked me if the Bible had gotten a hold of me, I was talking to him because I was in a class in Lamentations at the time, and I was sharing with him what had happened, and he said, you know God can take that, right? We have a big God who loves us. He can take anything we bring to him. So let's be real. And if we will do that, if we can bring these things to God that we're not sure we want to bring, it gives us a promise. We will find timely help just when we need it. Help before it's too late. Help to enter this life-giving gift that God wants us to have. There was this lady I used to work with up at Mill Creek Community Church, and we had a food bank at that church. And she would fight for that food bank, man. We'd be like, yeah, let's just leave it closed. We don't have anybody to staff it. And she'd go, no, we're going to find somebody. This thing is going to be open. And every time we talked about, man, this is just a big expense. I don't know if we should keep doing this. none of these people ever show up at our church again. They just come and take food from us. Like, these kind of dogs come up, and she would go, no, that is what we are here for. And I finally asked her about it, like, why are you so passionate about the food bank? And she said, because there was a time when I was growing up when my family had to decide, are we going to keep our rent or are we going to buy food? And if we had lost our place, I don't know if we would have been able to get back on our feet again. So for her, it was timely help that came just when she needed. I know that there have been times where I've received timely help. There's times that you probably have received timely help. I remember one day standing there, and Christina and I could not figure out how to get along. And she said, if we can't figure this out, we can't keep going like this. Things are going to fall apart, and God led us to this incredible retired pastor who could give us some marriage counseling and helped us figure out how to make our way forward. But timely help, help that if you don't get it, something's going to break. Our spiritual journey is described that God is there waiting to give us timely help right when we feel the crutch. Right when we feel the pressure, right when we feel tempted, right when we have a choice of either going down a good road or a bad road, God is there. So boldly show up, and what will you find? Grace. Nothing to be ashamed of because you're already forgiven. Grace and mercy and help. That's what God wants to give us. My dad and I both are really bad at admitting we need help when we're driving. Sort of going, yep, I got us lost. Now what? Stink at it. But if we've been able to do that, to go, we're lost. We blew it. Help get us on the right track. We would have had hope of making it to that Dodgers game. I want to read a scripture for you as I wrap up. Isaiah 53, 4 through 6. It says this. Surely he took up our pain, he bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, afflicted. He was pierced for our transgression, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we're healed. And then get this, verse 6, how it ends this passage. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us turned and go our own direction. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. We, the spiritually, directionally challenged, have a tendency to go our own way. And God is right there saying, listen to me. Hold fast to me. Bring it all to me, and I can help you find a better way. So as we kind of keep going in this Lent season, I want to encourage you to do that. He's here for us. God wants to walk with us through our days, so let's do it together. All right? That's great. God, thank you for being the most amazing high priest we could hope for, the pastor we could all hope for, one who has gone to heaven, one who knows how to lead us into life. Lord, we're sorry for our stubbornness and our pride and our finding our own direction. We trust you for that. God, thanks for not being a far-off God who's just a judge, who can sit far off and judge our lives and make us give an accounting at the end and see where we fell short, but instead being one who walked in our shoes with us, who loves us and cares for us and wants good things for us. So Lord, we put ourselves into your hands.